I'd like to call the regular board meeting to order at this time. Please come in and have a seat if you would. Mr. Copeland will offer the Pledge of Allegiance. Everybody please stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You may be seated.
Mr. Waller, can we have certification of the closed meeting, please?
Resolution of certification of the closed meeting of March 9th, 2017, pursuant to Section 2.2-3712 of the Code of Virginia 1950 as amended.
So moved.
Second.
Board Member Bouchard?
Yes.
Board Member Brooks Buck?
Yes.
Board Member Byram?
Yes.
Board Member Mitnick?
Yes.
Board Member Skeeter?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Copeland?
Aye.
Chairman DeBransky?
Yes.
Motion carried.
We'll go to public speakers on agenda items. Mr. Kevin Austin here to speak. Come forward, sir.
Kevin Austin, Sleepy Ridge Court, Suffolk, Virginia. I'm a former student of Driver Elementary and Chuckatuck Elementary, and a graduate of John Yates High School. After completing college, I returned to Suffolk, worked in this school division until retiring after a 39-year career in 2015 as the Chief of Operations. I come to you tonight with a concern related to the construction of new schools and how it affects the alumni and the history or legacy of the school buildings that are closed or razed. Unfortunately, Suffolk has done a poor job of opening new schools that continue to represent the established community of the school or schools. One need only to look at the rich histories preserved in schools in Chesapeake as an example. I'd be willing to bet that Oscar Smith High School would not be renamed if a new school were to be constructed as a replacement. That's the reason there's so much support for that school. Alumni of that school donate money and attend games there. The same is true at Great Bridge or Deep Creek, all the schools in Chesapeake. They understand that pride in a school also leads to pride in a community and ultimately pride in a school division. Yet, what did Suffolk do when a school was built to replace Southwestern Elementary? Suffolk opened it under a new name and ceased to recognize the well-documented history of that school. While I am encouraged that Florence Bowser will live on, I am sad that Driver Elementary, which I entered in 1959, will cease to exist. In 1990, in preparation of the opening of Nansman River and Lakeland High Schools, John Yates, John F. Kennedy, and Forest Glen High Schools were converted to middle schools and Suffolk High School was closed. Memorabilia from those schools was boxed to be stored at the maintenance department along with artifacts from other schools closed in Nansman County and Suffolk, such as Chuckatuck High School, East Suffolk High School, Holland High School, Whaleyville High School, and so on. And that memorabilia was put there until such time as we were told at that time that it would be put on display. Well, approximately 27 years have passed, and to my knowledge, those trophies and banners have never been put on display. I find this to be disturbing. But even more disturbing is the news that this memorabilia cannot be located. I have been contacted by alumni looking for these artifacts to display at class reunions. When I tell them the artifacts can be checked out through the maintenance department, Alumni tell me they've been told that the articles are not there. My question is, if not at the maintenance department, then where are those historical artifacts being stored? Through my own investigation, I have learned that those artifacts may have been thrown in the trash. If that is true, I, as well as the alumni of those schools, would like to know who authorized this. If it isn't true, or if it wasn't done with the approval, who took it upon themselves to destroy school property without proper authorization? It is my belief that the responsible party, if still employed, should be required to research and replace those banners and awards at their own expense or be terminated. Do you, as a school board member, care about the rich history of this school division? If so, who is responsible for the preservation of artifacts and historical records? I ask the school board to authorize an investigation into the whereabouts of the missing artifacts and establish protocol for maintaining the history of this school division and report their findings at a future board meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public speakers on agenda items? Any other speakers on agenda items? Thank you, Mr. Austin. Hearing none, we'll go to reports by the superintendent, Dr. Whitney.
Thank you and good evening. At this time, I'm going to start our good news report and call to the podium Ms. Bethann Bradshaw, our communication officer.
Believe it or not, there is some good news. Each month we take this opportunity to share with you and our viewing audience at home some of the great things that happen in our schools each and every day, some of the wonderful achievements of our students and our staff. Tonight we're excited to highlight a long-standing and ever-strong partnership that Suffolk Public Schools has with the Suffolk Education Foundation. As you know, the foundation is a 501c3 organization founded in 1993, specifically to raise money and community support for Suffolk Public Schools. They provide college scholarships, classroom instructional grants, and support of our STEM, fine arts, and professional development programs. I'd now like to call up representatives from the Suffolk Education Foundation Board of Directors. I think Ms. Karen Bricky will be joining us, and also the representative from the Suffolk School Board who serves on the board for the foundation, David Mitnick. And he will share with you some details on a brand new project from the Suffolk Education Foundation.
Good evening and thank you. My name is David Mitnick. I'm the immediate past president of the Suffolk Education Foundation. I'm here tonight to make a special presentation to Suffolk Public Schools that has the potential to touch thousands of lives of elementary school students for years to come. Since the fall of 2015, the foundation has been working on a project in memory of a former Suffolk Education Foundation board member who lost his personal fight with depression in July of that year. Ernie Lieber was a friend of the foundation and a friend of Suffolk Public Schools. Our board wanted to do something to assist students who may be having their own issues with sadness, loneliness, or bullying. The Suffolk Education Foundation is pleased to make this evening's presentation in honor of the memory of Ernie Lieber. Tonight we are here to present a buddy bench to Oakland Elementary School. When I put out the request in the fall as to which schools might be interested in a buddy bench, and you're probably asking what a buddy bench is, and I'll soon tell you, Oakland was the first school that responded to our request for interest in a buddy bench on their school playground. A buddy bench is a special place where children will be able to sit if they are feeling sad, lonely, or bullied. Other children in the school will be educated to go to the buddy bench and sit alongside that child to comfort them, to talk to them, and help in any way that they can. Adults will be watching when a child sits on the buddy bench and will make sure that the child is joined by another student. Elementary school counselors will educate the students around the buddy bench and its purpose. I'd like to recognize the elementary school counselors who are with us tonight, if you would please stand. Thank you very much for all you do for the children of Suffolk Public Schools. The Buddy Bench concept has gone nationwide ever since a young student named Christian in an elementary school in Doylestown, Pennsylvania, introduced the idea to his principal that he had seen in Germany when he attended school there. The Suffolk Education Foundation is pleased to bring Buddy Benches to the Suffolk Public Schools elementary schools. Our Buddy Benches are being paid for by grants and donations. The first bench is awarded with funds from a grant from the Obesity Healthcare Foundation. Their representative was unable to attend this evening. As I call your name and your organization, if the donors and the grantors would please stand, I would appreciate it. Other benches are being paid for by grants from the Suffolk Foundation, represented tonight by Kermit Hobbs, Vice President. The Suffolk Roartons, represented tonight by Sheriff E.C. Harris, and donations from the E. Talmadge Darden Fund, represented tonight by Mrs. Karen Bricky and Mr. Robbie Butler, who are administrators of the fund. Their benches were given in memory of their friends and co-workers, Mr. E. Talmadge Darden, and a former principal with Suffolk Public Schools, Dr. Milton R. Liverman. Our final bench, another bench, was donated by Mrs. Joyce Trump, a past superintendent, in memory of Dr. Milton R. Liverman. And finally, our donor is the Lieber family themselves. This is Ernie's family and represented tonight by Dr. Andrea Lieber. We'd like to thank all of our donors and grantors who have helped us with this project. Thank you. The Suffolk Education Foundation continues to raise funds for this project until all elementary schools have a buddy bench. At this time, I'd like to ask Ms. Karen Bricky and those individuals who are here tonight from Oakland, Ms. Dabney, principal, Dr. Wilkins, dean of students, and Ms. Grant Hudson, school counselor, to please join Ms. Bricky up on the stage. On behalf of the Suffolk Education Foundation, and because of a grant from the Obesity Healthcare Foundation, we are pleased to make the presentation of this Buddy Bench, a representative of all 11 Buddy Benches, to Oakland Elementary School in honor of Ernie Lieber. Karen, will you please unveil the Buddy Bench? Each of our benches has cost $750, including shipping and handling and the product themselves, and each is personalized with the name of the school and the words Buddy Bench, and each will have a plaque on the back announcing who sponsored the Buddy Bench and who it is in memory of. The first three Buddy Benches are going to Northern Shores Elementary School and Kilby Shores Elementary School, in addition to Oakland, and they will be delivered as soon as security measures have been taken at the schools and the cement slabs will be installed for them to be mounted on. On behalf of the Suffolk Education Foundation, I would like to thank Dr. Whitney for his support of this program and to Mr. Terry Napier, Director of Facilities and Planning, who workers will be assembling the benches and securing them on the playgrounds at each school. Thank you for allowing us to make this presentation here this evening.
Foundation.
Next, under Superintendent's Report, you can see we have our new schools construction. As you know, we are building two new schools, an elementary school, Florence Bowser, and Cherry Middle School in the northern part of Suffolk. I'm going to call to the podium Mr. Terry Napier, our Director of Plant and Facilities, to share with you a brief update as to the progress of these schools. Mr. Napier.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It's my pleasure to be here tonight to give you an update on both of our new schools. Well, we're going to begin with Florence Bowser Elementary School.
I can't hear him.
Speak in the mic, Mr. Napier, please. Thank you.
We're going to begin with Florence Bowser Elementary School. And we are not there yet, but we're getting closer by the day. So that's what it's going to look like. We don't want anyone to forget. So we're going to start with that slide every time we give you an update. Project status, major work completed to date. All below concrete slab work, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, all of that stuff that you do not see, that's 100% complete at the Florence Bowser site as of this week. Concrete floor slab, 95% complete. Concrete masonry walls, 55% complete. If you drive by there at any point, you can see there's a whole lot going on in terms of walls coming up out of the ground. So we're real pleased with that. I can tell you that this week, our masonry crew there went from 12 to about 40. So this is really good news. Given the weather that we've had, we've decided to up the labor there a little bit. So everything's looking good over there as far as masonry work. Site utilities, those are 100% complete. The BMP, which is the stormwater retention pond, and I'm going to show you a picture of that in a minute, 100% complete. The parking lot, the sub-base asphalt has been put in. Most of the gutters are in. So we're making progress at that. The final grade will not be put in until just before we're ready to open the building. Turn lane on Nansman Parkway, that was cut out about a week ago. We have not paved that yet, but we will be doing so soon. Structural steel, that's the stuff that goes on top that holds the roof up. We started that this past week. Today we had about 8 tractor trailer loads of steel arrive at Florence Bowser. Last week they started putting some of the stuff on the mechanical rooms, the gymnasium, actually we have some roofing going up on that already. So there's a lot going on as far as structural steel. At this point in time, we are 28% complete with that project overall. So we're pleased with that. Major work scheduled in the next 2 months. We're gonna complete the CMU, and I apologize for these phases. Phase 1 and 2 and all of that that's on it. We break the building down into phases and areas, and I don't have a map for you, but all this refers to is different sections around the building. We're gonna complete the CMU, which is concrete block, in phase 1 and phase 2. We're gonna complete CMU on the first floor of phase 3 in the next 2 months. We're gonna complete all the structural steel in phase 1. We're gonna pour the slab deck in phase 2, we're going to begin roofing phase 1, which means we're beyond structural steel. At that point, we're actually going to get a roof on it. The chillers and AHUs 2 and 3, that's HVAC equipment, that's going to arrive in the next 2 months. And we're going to start putting some of that in place. Masonry veneer, which is the brick that goes on the outside, that's also going to start here very soon. We're going to begin MEPRIs, and what that means is, and we love our acronyms, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, rough-ins. That's going to start in phase 1 and 2, also in the next couple of months. All of this is very good news for us. We've got some pictures we want to show you. This is inside the cafetorium. You recall when we were out there for the dedication?
Yeah.
None of this was there. That picture was taken a week ago. If you're standing inside that area today, you can look up, you can see structural steel going up in there already. So that's already changed in the last week. So that's good news as well. Exterior west side mechanical room. If you're facing the building, this is the back left-hand corner. So all of that is going in. This is the roofing going in the mechanical electrical room. Steel joists and roofing going in the fire pump room, which is also on that back left-hand corner. That's the front exterior view from the parking lot. So as you can see, we've got a building there now. So it's come a long way in a very short amount of time. That's bus loop paving. We've most of that, there's a small section of that that we left without pavement so that we could stage some materials in there. And we had a little dirt issue that we're working on right now. But most of the pavement has been, the base pavement has been laid in the parking lot. That's curb and gutter along Nansen Parkway. That's where the turn lane will be, actually in about a month. That's front view, including the curb and gutter, from the left-hand side of the building. Actually, the corner, that would be about where the corner of the old building was. And there's our retention pond. Well, we're very proud of this retention pond. There was some issues, or some concerns, would we be able to drain the site? Because we had a history there of flooding. It was pretty bad. This is what has created a situation where we will never see that again, basically. What we did, we raised the site a little bit. We've got all the parking lot structures in. We've got the building in now. And what this does, everything drains underground, and it goes into this pond. And it's approximately an acre and a half. We don't have one anywhere else that's that large. It's so large, the city has required us to put fountains in it so that we can keep that water, you know, fairly clean, no algae, that sort of thing. So that is what has made it possible for us to do away with all that flooding that used to take there, place there before. Any questions about the elementary school?
How far along is it, do you think? 50% completed at this time?
28%. 28% this week.
Okay, great.
Which is right on schedule.
Are you going to put ducks in that pond?
We could.
That would be.
We thought about
idea.
Putting fish in there. The fence that goes around, we're so far along with that, we're actually going to go ahead and fence it in.
Yeah.
The water has begun to rise in it, which is a good thing. That's what it's supposed to do. But it's nice.
I don't think you'll be able to keep
it. You know, I know it's silly to stand up and brag about and tell you how much we love our pond, but we really do like it. All right, Colonel Fred Cherry Middle School. There's what it's going to look like. We aren't quite there yet either, but we're getting there. Project status on Cherry Middle School. Major work completed to date. Below concrete slab, just as we had with Bowser. Mechanical, electrical, plumbing installation. We're at 80% on the middle school. Concrete floor slabs, we're at 70%. Concrete masonry walls, 60% complete. Structural steel, we started that about 2 weeks ago at that project. Right now, we're about 22% overall completion, and that's right where we would expect to be at this point. Major work scheduled in the next 2 months. Again, we have area, at that building, we have area A, B, C1, C2, and D. All this refers to as different areas in the building. Complete area B, under slab utilities, those are the things that you cannot see. Electrical, mechanical, plumbing. We're going to complete area A, concrete floor slabs. We're also going to complete concrete masonry walls in all of the areas listed there. We're also going to complete structural steel in area B, C1, and C2. Major work scheduled in the next 2 months. We're going to start the brickwork there, the masonry veneer. Those chillers also will be set in place. We're going to start putting the roof on in area B. We're going to complete all the site utilities, so we'll be at 100%. We're also going to complete all on-site concrete, so that will be at 100%. The stone base in all areas to be paved, that's the parking lots, and the road that goes around the building to the bus ramp and the bus ramp in the rear. All of the stone will be down there, and it'll be ready for pavement, and we hope to have all of that done in the next 2 months. I think I went the wrong way. There we go. There is a front elevation showing the gymnasium. And what we did, if you recall, we started at the gymnasium and we're working out in both directions and back from that. And the reason for that, there are very few underground utilities under the gym. So it's a good place to start. And it's grown to the right. We haven't put up any brick walls to the left of that yet, but it's coming very soon. This is area A, looking back towards the gym from the left-hand side of that building if you're standing in the front of it. Area B, looking back towards the electrical room and the gym's to the left. So if you're facing the building, that's on the right-hand corner. This is the rear elevation of Area B, the kitchen and the cafeteria. Now this building, if you stand in front of it, it's a little bit difficult to tell that there's a whole lot going on behind because the gym is so tall. That gym's actually going to be close to 40 feet tall. But there's a lot going on there that you don't see when you drive by from the road. That's classroom area C1 looking back towards the cafeteria. Interior looking towards the rear of the gym, classroom wing to the right. They do have walls going up in that classroom wing to the right of the gymnasium. Interior looking towards the kitchen and the cafeteria. Again, interior looking toward the main locker area. So as you can see, and this is standing at the south end of the bus loop, which would be if you're facing the building to the left. So we got a lot going on there. We're in good shape. Just again, we're at 28% on the elementary school. We're at 22% on the middle school. As far as our completion dates, we're right on schedule with that. We've lost very little time due to weather, and this is a good thing. And we actually have 7 or 8 days per month already calculated in for weather. We haven't used many of those. So our timeline right now looks real good. So we're pleased with that. Any questions about either building?
Questions for board members? None.
Thank you.
Mr. Napier.
And the last item on the reports by the superintendent is calendar of special events. I'll ask you to bring your attention to page 29. Has a list of activities that are going to be taking place. Some have already taken place, but you can see listed on page 29 those activities. And that concludes the superintendent's report. Back to you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Dr. Whitney. Board members, if you'd look at the consent agenda at this time and see if any of the items need to be moved, we'll take a minute to look at them, please.
May I speak to number 20?
Yes.
I would like to bring your attention to item number 20, the name for the Prudence Center. You may recall last month we talked about a name change as we make some modifications at the Prudence Center. The actual changed name that we're proposing is the College and Career Academy at Prudence. I think that's different from what we presented to you earlier, but we have gone back based on some input that some of you have shared with us. We feel like the term College and Career Academy fits the center primarily because it is talking about getting students ready for college, but also career pathways. College and Career Academy at Prudence.
These are all action items. If we have no questions.
I do.
Okay.
I still don't like the name. I think it should be a preparatory school. And if you're going to put in college and career, it's the name's too long anyway, but if it's going to be that long, I think it should be the College and Career Preparatory Academy at Prudence. Because it's not a college academy and it's not a career academy. It's a preparation for those. But just my idea.
Anybody else? Want us to take it out of the voting?
Well, I mean, if I'm the only one that feels this way, if everyone is totally satisfied with the name as it is, then there's no reason to take it out of voting. I just, I think the name is too long, and frankly, a little bit pretentious, but I think I may be the only one.
Do the board members have input?
I'd just like to ask the people who sit on the Prudent Committee, what other names were discussed?
Other names that were discussed, I think originally we had it the Prudent Center, the Prudent College and Career Academy. We took that out because when you say Prudent College, it sounds like it is implying that it's a college. Other names, I'm going to turn to staff. If any of you all recall names that we talked about, that the committee talked about, Dr. Harrison, our assistant superintendent, may have a better memory than me. Okay.
Different variations, I'll come to the mic. Good evening. So the two variations were the ones that you just shared, the College and Career Academy at Pruden and the Pruden College and Career Academy were the two different variations that we talked about.
Is the name Pruden required?
I don't think it's required, but it's our recommendation considering that the land was given for by the Pruden family. We wanted to keep it in.
Right. Okay. I just was curious to know. As I said, I may be the only one that I just think this is such a long name that I don't understand why it can't be called the Pruden Academy or the Pruden Preparatory Academy, something that is shorter. This name seems so long that it's almost like, that was the week that was. I mean, it just sounds like it's just much too long.
I think people will still call it the Pruden Center.
Probably.
May I answer, Mr.
Sure.
Mitnick? The committee wouldn't decide this. This was because of the fact that it's now going to be under the auspices of the city of the school system, Suffolk. Okay. Suffolk School Board.
All right, so it wasn't a discussion at the committee.
It would come through them now.
Right.
It would come through us, really,
right.
Because no longer will we operate as a three-member board. Three-member board from the city of Suffolk. Mm-hmm.
It'll be the entire board. It'll be one of our schools.
It'll be now under auspices of the Suffolk City School Board.
Right.
So this is the reason why Dr. Whitney and his staff are presenting this name.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
I'm just going to say I think the name, no disrespect to the committee. I know that you've tried to include everything in it, but I agree with you, Mr. Mitnick, that it's going to be called the Pruden Center, and that sounds like a very good name. And I just think, that or something shorter. It just comes across to me as sounding pretentious, like we're trying to, it's going to be a wonderful, it already is a wonderful preparatory school, and it's going to be even greater. I don't think it needs to have such a long name, and it would be my suggestion that we give it at least another month so that maybe other people on the board might want to think about it a little bit. It's just such a long name. Yes, ma'am.
May I make a comment before we make a decision? I think that, I don't know because I wasn't on the committee, but I think that the whole notion of College and Career Academy had to do with the fact that we're trying to change the perspectives with regard to the fact that it is, whether we call it or not, the Pruden Center. But I think that when we talked about the concept of the center, we were talking about bringing a diverse population, not just what it had been before. And I'm sure that's why we looked at, why they looked at something else, because we
and
had
I,
discussed.
I agree. I understand
bringing in
that.
A different population.
I understand that, but I understand that, and that's quite noble. Please don't get me wrong. But I think that it's noble to have a career academy. I think that is noble. And to try to say that we're diversifying when we already have something which is a great idea and much better suited for career choices for our kids. This is what the future is going to be. And we're at the cutting edge of the future. I don't think we need to try to say that we're diversifying, because what we're doing is offering an excellent opportunity for students who want this education. And so to try to make this long name so that we're saying we're inclusive is totally unnecessary, I believe.
Or can we get a motion to either table it, accept it, or deny it at this point?
Before you do that, Mr. Chair, I don't know if Dr. Harrison can tell us, as the committee came up with this name, did they have a reasoning behind using it this way?
Yes, absolutely. Part of the reason is, as we rebrand the school and want to make it more appealing for a broader range of students, we thought it was important to include college and career in the name, because many of the students are going in lots of different directions after high school. And we want to make sure that they understand that this is an opportunity to prepare students who are pursuing lots of different pathways, not just career immediately after high school, not just college, but both. That's what we are preparing our students for, both college and career. And so that in the name really sort of captured that.
Aren't all three of our high schools, aren't all four of our middle schools, and aren't all of our elementary schools already doing that? We are preparing our kids for college and careers.
Yes.
It's not like all of a sudden we have to rebrand anything.
Well, I think the committee felt, as well as I think some of you have expressed an interest of making certain that, one, we best utilize the space and the programs that we offer at the current Pruden Center. We have not had the enrollment at capacity over the last several years, and I think part of that is the misconception that attending the Pruden Center, or some refer to it as Votech Center, that it's a pathway of just going towards a career or a trade. With the changes of the courses that we're adding there with mechatronics and the cybersecurity, in addition to courses that are already there, it's an option and opportunities that students may take advantage of and not only go a career path, but they may also decide to go to college as well, as many do. So our thought is we want to eliminate that misconception that it's only for trade or Votech or career, it's also college and career. While I know a name won't change that, but what will change it is the programs and how the programs are taught. And we've also, as we shared with you, I think last month, have made some of those changes as well.
Well, it could be, for example, the Pruden Technology Center would include all of that because of the need for technology in everything that we do, and it's much shorter, and it doesn't leave out anybody. The Pruden Center for Opportunities, I mean, anything shorter than this is all. I would like to move that we table this action for at least one more school meeting and just allow us to bat it around a little bit, because it's a name that's going to be there for years.
Do we have a second? Do we have a second to the table motion? Anybody going to second it?
Okay.
Motion fails for lack of a second. So can we go ahead on and vote on it?
I move that we use the name that the committee has come up with.
Well, we don't have to.
I thought you said
you're taking them all together.
I thought you said
this would be a vote on the whole consent agenda.
Okay.
I move that we accept the consent agenda as listed.
Second the motion.
Board Member Bouchard?
No.
Board Member Brooks Buck?
Yes.
Board Member Byram?
Yes.
Board Member Mitnick?
Yes.
Board Member Skeeter?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Copeland?
Aye.
Chairman DeBransky?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Unfinished business. Dr. Whitney.
Yes. As you well know, during our joint meeting with City Council, Mrs. Forsman presented a revised proposed financial plan for fiscal year 2017-2018. I felt it was necessary for her to share with you the changes that we've included in that, which is the exact same presentation that she shared during our joint meeting. At this time, Mrs. Forsman, our Executive Director of Finance, will share those changes with you. Ms. Forsman.
Good evening. As shared in the joint meeting that we had, I guess it's been about a week ago, our budget from the state is complete.
Excuse me, Ms. Forsman, you're going to speak a little more into the mic.
All right, I'm going to try to get closer.
I know
closer.
You're very
shy. Is that better?
Yes.
All right, I have to lean way over. The state has finished their budget. The General Assembly has gone home. And we have received our calculation tool from the state regarding the state money. The good news is there's about $116,000 more. The bad news is it came into lottery funds. So lottery funds are not guaranteed funds, as you're aware. But that being said, that brought our operating fund to $141.3 million, or a 3.8% increase for next year. The grants fund reduced slightly, and the food service fund increased slightly. So our overall proposed budget next year is $160.9 million, or an increase of 2.64%. Again, these are slides you've seen, so I'm going to go through them a little more quickly this evening. But the operating fund makes up the majority of our funds, the grants fund being second and food service third. And when we look at our major classifications as defined by the state, you can see that 74.18% of our budget is spent on instruction. The next one would be the, sorry, I can't see through the thing, is the maintenance and operations at 7.94%. When we look by object code, 85.59% of our budget is compensation and benefits. So when we look at the changes in revenue, the supplemental lottery increase went up by $2 million. Now, this is from last time we published the budget to now. It went up $2 million. Fringe benefits portions increased. The state portion of revenue increased $573,000. There were some small program increases and decreases that make up about $19,000. As you know, the General Assembly removed the bonus of 1.5%, so they reduced the revenue for that. And they added a 2% bonus effective February 2018 for SOQ positions only. And the difference there is they dropped our $600,000 down to about $400,000. So that's a $216,000 decrease of incentive money, which is guaranteed money.
Excuse me, Ms. Forsman, what positions were they for?
They're for SOQ. The state, SOQs. When they give us raises, they give us for SOQ positions. That's what they're funding.
Okay, that's not all. No,
not all positions, only there. SOQ that positions. That's all the state funds, sir.
All right.
The regional special ed tuition was a decrease of $203,597. And remedial summer school decreased by $136,377. That will not affect summer school. It's just a decrease. It's a fluctuation in students. We're asking an additional, the proposed budget has an additional local appropriation request of $2 million. And there's increased funding in the federal and other revenue that we've received over the last 4 years. We do it on a rolling four-year average of $166,000 for a total revenue increase of $4.2 million. Items there that have the asterisk after them mean that there are also expense increases on the other side of that.
Ms. Forsman.
Yes,
before
ma'am.
Before you leave that, we do have some of our students who are still there. Still
absolutely.
Here.
Yes, ma'am. That's just a
deep. Would you tell them what an SOQ position is and about what population it affects? Not the percentage, but what type of teachers would get those raises?
It's teachers and guidance counselors. It's done on the number of students that are expected at each level. And the state has formulas for each level that they allow us to have teachers and guidance counselors, principals, assistant principals. They have formulas for each and every one, and they only do the prevailing cost, which means the average cost across the state of two-year-old data to decide how much public education costs.
So it's not every staff member in every building.
No, sir.
No,
not
in
every,
fact.
Or not even every, the amount we actually pay the staff members. It's a prevailing cost, an average cost across the state.
A quick, simple example might be, for example, we receive SOQ funding, say, in a high school per, say, 900 students. We may receive one high school assistant principal funding. Obviously, all of our high schools have more than one assistant principal. So those other assistant principals we have to pay for locally. Mm-hmm. So the raise that is included is only for those SOQ positions that they are funding already, if that makes sense.
And what about the other people?
That's when we have to add local money to give them that raise.
So it it won't affect everybody, because everybody, whatever they don't give, we make up for.
We have to make up for, exactly.
Okay.
Or we could give, and we never would, I would never recommend, only SOQ positions the raise, because right. That's the only money that we receive from the state. We've never done that, nor would I recommend such.
Okay, so you're saying that those people, their raise comes from the state, the other people will still get the raise, but it comes from local.
Local funds, yes.
Okay. Right. So you can see here the history of state funds. And when we look at 2008-2009 funding, which isn't on the chart, you can see that we're still, this many years later, not back at state funding. In 2008-2009, we were receiving $86.4 million. Next year, the proposed is $83.4 million. So we're still well below 10 years ago.
And I think that's rather significant to show and to think about, because in 2008-2009, it was $86 million that we were receiving. So while we can see, looking at the state funds, we're getting back to where we were, but it's a matter of just that, getting back to where we were. So it's a matter of attempting to maintain as far as programs and things of that nature.
When we look at our local revenue, this is funded by the City of Suffolk, you can see here 5 years of our request and the city's response to our request and what they funded. And you can see that the request for 2017-2018 is $55.8 million. Again, the entire budget is based upon our strategic planning and the school board goals, and each and every program, if you look at the program, has how it's tied to those goals, how those targets are tied to those goals. When we look at the expense portion, what's changed from the last time we presented this as Dr. Whitney's proposed budget was, of course, the bonus went away. So the bonus went away, the state has provided $400,000 for a raise, but this proposal has a staff average raise of 2.4% at a cost of $1.9 million. Again, when we talk about this, as Dr. Whitney said in the joint meeting, it's an average across the scale. People at the top will see the 1%, and then it's graduated throughout the scale, and we'll bring you that scale. Dr. Whitney, are we gonna do that at another time?
Yes.
Yes, thank you, I'm sorry. So the employer contribution to retirement is $830,897, that's the increase. The Pruden Center is $737,087. The increased cost to health benefits with the four plans as proposed is $602,015. And the increased cost of workman's comp benefits is $142,781. So the total increase in expense is $4.2 million.
Ms. Forsman, could I just ask you if this, just so that our public will understand this, just can you tell me if this is true or not? If to give a 1% raise to staff, doesn't that cost about $1 million? So 1% kind of equals $1 million, so that would help the public to understand that we have to receive $1 million to give 1%.
Yes, ma'am. That's a cost of living 1% across the board is about $1.2 million. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
You said 1.2.
1.2 for a cost of living. For 1%.
For 1%.
Okay.
Any further questions?
Yes. Ms. Forsman, can you tell us how the implementation of the compensation plan occurred?
Yes, sir. The classification and compensation plan was presented to the school board in January of 2015 by Evergreen Solutions. It called for four phases, and it was implemented over two fiscal years. Phase one was implemented in 2015-2016. It included 10 classifications on our support scale that were paid at more than 20% below market. The raises for those 10 classifications ranged from 5.25% to 21.7%.
Basically, these raises were in the middle of the scale, is that correct?
These raises were across the scale, but they ranged in value from 1 year to the next, of 5.25% to 21.7%. The teacher's scale was changed completely with an average raise across the scale of 5.6%. Again, the range of raises across the scale ranged from 2% to 9.5%. And at that time, the superintendent's salary was identified as being more than 20% below market, but there was some research that was needed, so it was pushed to phase four. And there were changes to titles, such as we dropped the title secretary and added administrative assistant. Also implemented in 2015-16 was phase two, part one, and this was support staff who were identified as paid more than 10.5% below the market, and those raises ranged from 5.25 to 28%. Phase two, part two, was done in 2016-2017, this current fiscal year. Support staff who were paid greater than 1.9% to 10.49% below market were included in this portion, and those raises for those folks ranged from 5.25% to 10.5%.
Did that include bus drivers as well?
That was not part of the paying classification plan.
It wasn't? Okay.
No, sir. Phase three is ongoing because it required us to review and redo the market survey every 5 to 7 years, so that's an ongoing phase with no cost specifically to it in the first or second year. And then phase four was implemented. Phase four included administrators who were paid greater than 8.1% to 14.8% below the market, and those raises were at 10.5%. It also included the superintendent's salary research was complete, and again, it was at more than 20% below market, and so the school board approved a raise for the superintendent at 13% at that time after his evaluation.
Actually, it was being recommended for 20%, but we remained sort of below the 20 and dropped it to 13%. Is that correct?
The plan said that Dr. Whitney was paid greater than 20%, less than the market at the time that the survey was done.
And so waiting with the phase made it even lower because other people were getting raises that we compared them to in different places.
The comparison was done in 2016, so you received up-to-date raise for all superintendents across the region.
And it was below 20%. Not more than 20, above 20%.
The plan said at the time the plan was done, it said more than 20%.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions, board members?
And for our other employees who were being paid less than 20%, we gave them raises. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am, in two phases.
What will this bring us now, Ms. Forsman, as far as where will this bring our teachers and our staff now if we implement this salary scale? As far as
we really don't know that because we don't know what the other school divisions are going to do next year, sir. We won't know until we receive their pay scales to know where we stand. We've compared them to current year, but we haven't compared them to next year.
Can we have a comparison that you've done recently?
We did a comparison of teacher scales current year, and I provided that to Dr. Whitney, but we haven't done a comparison for next year. We don't know those scales yet.
I'm not worried about next year. I'm saying,
yeah.
Can we look at the comparison for this past year?
Yes, sir. We have that information we can provide.
Mm-hmm. He's asking for teachers, aren't you?
Excuse me?
Are you asking for teachers, Dr. Dobrinsky?
Yeah, teachers.
The one thing I'd like to make clear is that when every other employee of the district was given what they were due based upon the classification and compensation plan, the last person to get what they were due was the superintendent.
Yeah.
And we were following the compensation plan as it was presented to us over 2 years ago now. and we were completing the plan. And that was the board's desire.
It was a unanimous desire as well, yes. Any other questions or concerns? Thank you, Ms. Forsman.
Sir.
This will be for, we haven't set a date for yet.
Right, that's the new business.
Okay, we'll do that. New business, Dr. Whitney.
Yes, as you can see listed here, scheduling of a special school board meeting to approve the operating budget for 2017-2018. I have presented three dates for you that may work, and you can choose. Dates proposed to schedule a special school board meeting are listed as March 15th, March 16th at 9, March 17th, in the morning from 9 to 12, or any time between those hours. There's a sheet on the left-hand side if you want to take a look at those. Thank you.
It's Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday.
Right.
Well, maybe we could start by asking board members of those three dates when they cannot.
Yeah, Friday's not a good day for me.
Okay, so then we would hopefully knock out next Friday, and we would be left with Wednesday and Thursday. So is there anybody who can't do Wednesday or Thursday?
The afternoon is better for me, but I mean.
On which day?
On Wednesday. That's, yeah, they said Wednesday afternoon.
Wednesday afternoon is good for you.
We do it at 4 p.m. on Wednesday the 15th.
4 p.m. Wednesday the 15th?
For me, sure.
Is that okay after our next school board meeting?
No. It's before.
Don't we need to consider some of the things that people have come forward with?
Yes.
Before we make that decision?
I think we do. I think we need to have a meeting prior to that.
Yeah.
So you want to wait till after March?
Well, we don't need
after
we don't
March,
make,
but
no. If you want to have a work session prior to on this particular day, or are you talking before the time frame that we've given you is because we have to have the budget, where's Mrs. Forsman, to the city by April 1st.
So we have to have it in March before the next school board meeting.
May I make a suggestion? We could proceed with the date, the 4 o'clock on Wednesday, and see how far we get. I mean, and then reschedule, I mean, for one more date after that, if we need it.
Or if you'd like to have March 15th as a work session.
I think it'd be better.
And then
that's
we
right.
can
that's
schedule
what I
another
I'm
meeting
sorry.
For approval.
That's good.
Yeah,
good.
That's what I meant.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think we should do that. That's my
Let's do it
suggestion.
Like 3:30, so we have enough time.
You said 3:30 now?
I think if it's before the board meeting, yes. So we have enough time to discuss
no,
it.
No. There's no board meeting.
He's suggesting that instead of a board meeting on that date, that we have a work session.
Okay, that's fine.
And then
that's
schedule fine. Another date for the board meeting, the board special board meeting.
That works.
Okay. Is everybody okay with 4 o'clock on Wednesday?
Yeah, I'm with me.
Wednesday, what's the date?
That's the March 15th, the Ides of March.
March 15th, Wednesday, 4 o'clock.
Yeah, beware the Ides of March.
And place to be determined. We'll determine a place. We'll get back with you as far as where the location is.
Can we meet in that conference?
Sure, we can. It is an action item, yes.
Someone will need to make a motion that we have a work session on that.
Okay,
date.
I move that we have a work session on Wednesday, March 15th at 4 p.m.
Second.
Board Member Bouchard?
Yes.
Board Member Brooks Buck?
Yes.
Board Member Byram?
Yes.
Board Member Mitnick?
Yes.
Board Member Skeeter?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Copeland?
Aye.
Chairman Dobranski?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Okay, we have public speakers on non-agenda items. Is Angelo Stone here? Angelo Stone. Apparently he's already spoken.
Need to call him now.
Reginald Darden, Mary Chandler, any of you here? Apparently they've already spoken, so we'll go ahead on business by board members. Start with Ms. Bouchard.
Oh, okay. Okay, I just have one thing to say. I want to thank Oakland Elementary School for inviting me and my dog Scout Monday for their Arts and Literary Day. It was wonderful. Scout and I got the opportunity to read Skippy John Jones and the Big Bones to the first grade class, and I appreciate that very much. And I just wanted to say one other thing. I did get an email from Creekside Elementary asking me, and I'm sure other people, to judge their writings. And I would ask if any of you are out there, if somebody would email me and let me know that that's still an offer. Thank you.
Ms. Byer.
I just wanted to comment. We were away in Charlottesville yesterday for a wonderful board workshop with the VSBA, and I think we all enjoyed that, and I'm grateful that we were able to participate in that. I think it helps us as a board. And I want to say to those that appeared this evening, the bus drivers, the teachers, and so forth, we do understand and we do feel for you. As we said, I think it takes $1.2 million to get a 1% raise, and we're trying to work with what we have. Everyone up here has served in education, and we know it's often an unrewarded occupation, but I sincerely, and I believe every member of this board sincerely believes, we're trying to move in the right direction. I would love to see all of our employees from the top to the bottom get a massive raise and all the things that we would like to see come true. But, you know, we're listening to you, and I want you to know that. And it weighs heavy on my heart, and I'm sure it weighs heavy on everyone's heart. You know, we're not in this because we make a lot of money.
We haven't got a raise since I've been on the board.
But we're in this because we care so much about public education, and we care about the people in our communities, and we care about the students, and we love those kids, and we're devoted to it. And I think everyone here is. But we do hear what you're saying. I want you to realize that.
Dr. Bott.
I'm always excited this evening when I listen to the graduates and I listen to the young people talk about their plans and their hopes for the future. And it's my hope that as the years go by and as you consider whatever profession you're going in, I've been a teacher my whole life for 45 years. On some level, somewhere, most of that time was spent in public schools. And I realized that the rewards are not short-term rewards, they're long-term rewards. But when I see young people who have been through a 13-year process and come out looking fine and doing fine with hopes for the future, then I know I've done my job. I know I'll never be a millionaire as an educator, and that's okay, because my whole life I worked for what doing what I love to do, and so it's okay with me.
Mr. Mitnick, thank you.
Yes, I'd like to congratulate Ms. Bess and the Career and Technical Education Department. On the 16th of February, I had an opportunity to see our students in the non-traditional career extravaganza, and it's a great opportunity that's put on by our CTE department and their advisory committee to give our students an opportunity to meet with representatives and to consider those non-traditional careers that they wouldn't have an opportunity if there wasn't such an event. So congratulations, Ms. Bess, for doing a fine job, and keep up the good work. And I'd just like to add to what Ms. Byram said. You have a unique board because everybody at one time was an educator. Mm-hmm. And we do feel for our teachers, and we would wish we could go to City Council and ask for millions of dollars, but We've got to be real, and we know what we can ask for and what we can't ask for. But it's not because you're not appreciated. I took offense to that comment, and we do appreciate everything that our teachers do and all of our staff in Suffolk Public Schools. And one final note, I'd like to ask Dr. Whitney, next month, could you give us a community service update for our seniors?
Yes.
Thank you.
I only have a question. As we looked at the new middle school, did not Carol's Cherry middle initial belong in that?
No. Remember, I was going to add the middle initial because I was going to leave the Colonel off, but when they explained that they wanted the Colonel as a part of the name, I left that alone.
There's no place you look, you won't see that V in the middle of his name.
Well, like I said, they put Colonel up there, so that's why they did that, but that's what we voted on.
Okay. I just didn't know if we were making a mistake. Thank you. That's it.
Well, I'll make it short, but I listened at, I think we had 18 people to appear before this evening, and I think some think that we are millionaires up here, but we were all educators, and we have an ear for their concerns, and I feel that we have to recognize the fact that we're working on a plan, and that compensation board made recommendations. Not only for the teachers, but it made it for the administrators as well. And they are human, and therefore, we're not going to be giving them any more than what they deserve either. I personally wouldn't be in favor of doing that, to be honest with you. But I feel that we want the teachers to understand that we are interested in their and what they have done. We appreciate what they are doing. There's a lot of work in being a teacher today. I marvel at the work they have to do. But it goes with the territory. And if we don't do it, then we're going to be criticized because our schools aren't credited. We have children. We don't have a choice who comes into our school system, the public school system. They come. The private schools can select whoever goes and who comes into their schools. We don't have that choice. So we have to meet them where they are. Sometimes we don't get the necessary resources. And we appreciate the young man who came in and said he volunteered and whatever, and we really appreciate that. We have several people who volunteer. I know out in Pioneer, we have the Masonic person go out and teach math and whatever. The men go out there and participate in the school system. We work diligently at that school, and I have to support what Mr. Kevin Austin said tonight, that this was the point I was trying to drive home. When you change names of school, you change the allegiance sometimes with people who are identified with certain schools. Once you change the name, they no longer identified with it. I'm thinking about Forest Glen High School. My son finished Forest Glen High School. But now Lakeland, he has no identity with Lakeland. But if it had made Forest Glen High School, they will still be very active. But we took the attitude in Holland that regardless what the name of the school was, because it's in Holland, we're going to support it. So we give Pioneer School nearly $1,000 every year for instruction. That's just cash money because we appreciate having the school there. But I hope that in the future, I won't be on the board, but don't just throw names around at random. Have some meaning for the names. Names mean a lot to people. So with that, I'm going to close my conversation, my discussion with, my talk with what I had to say, but we would like to say to the teachers, don't give up on us and don't down the school system because of your personal vendetta or whatever you have, because any one of us could do that if we felt that way. And I have to say this too, and then I'm gonna be quiet. I was asked in 1970, my wife and I both were asked to go to Chesapeake. She worked in Southampton and I worked in Suffolk. And there was a whole lot more money going to Chesapeake, but our loyalty to our very respective school system, we remained where we were. And I'm proud of the fact that I gave Suffolk 36 years, and I'm proud of the fact that I did that. And I didn't get a lot of money out of it either, but I did get some reward from a young man who called me last night, said, Mr. Colton, I'm writing a book, and I'd like to know if I can use your name, because you meant so much to me as a seventh grade teacher. You didn't only teach me as a student, you made me a man. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Dr. Dr., I just wanted to say, there was one teacher tonight that said something that really got my attention that I wish that we could look into beyond salaries. She said, she talked about the comparing the amount of just work that she had to do compared to other school systems. She was talking about a 17-page lesson plan that she had to prepare every week. I think it would be worthwhile for us to look more deeply into that to see if we can't lessen that type of burden on our teachers. Because it may be that we are being redundant, and it may be that we are requiring things that are absolutely unnecessary and eat up their time that they can't be using for teaching.
More than willing to do that. Ironically enough, I presented to our instructional team an article that talked about why teachers are leaving, and it talked about the workload. It had salary in there, but it talked a lot about the workload and expectations. And so they're going to be pulling together a committee. I don't know if Dr. Harrison has a comment she might want to add. I don't know where you all are with that yet. It was a few weeks, maybe a week ago, that I sent that to her. Dr. Harrison, our assistant superintendent, please.
Good evening again. That is certainly an issue that we are addressing as a curriculum and instructional team. Our team actually meets on a weekly basis, and we've begun to look at our benchmark assessments as well as just taking a look overall at some of the things that we are requiring of our schools. And, you know, so that's something that we're in the beginning phases of that process of reviewing all of those different things so that we can ensure that what we are asking of our schools is what's necessary to move student achievement forward, and that if there's anything that they are being required to do that is beyond, above and beyond what's really needed for that, that we can begin looking at how we can eliminate some of those extraneous things that might be required of some of our schools.
And teachers will be a part of that discussion also.
That's good, because we need to listen to what they're saying to us, because this thing about having to reproduce something that's already there is just, I mean, if that's true, that's just ridiculous. So, I mean,
and I agree, that is very concerning, and I will be looking into that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. But well, since we're on that, I like to say something, and they can research it before we meet. I heard the young lady say that she paid an organizational dues. I would like to see us, if it's a part of that particular disciplinary academic activity, then we need to look at paying those dues for those persons. That's staff development.
I agree. And some we do. It's on a limited basis, but we can certainly look at exactly what dues she was referring to and what we do offer and let them know what's available, because obviously there are a number of associations, but generally for some of our specialty teachers, because they have limited special professional development opportunities, we do send them to things. They should not have to pay in order to get the reduced price. So we can look into that.
Dr. DeBransky, there was one thing that I just wanted to say out loud. I think that one of the things that we need to do, and the staff can help as well, is help people understand if they're looking for progress in the school system and where we actually stand. The great school's website is you go on the internet and you write what you want. That's how you come up with the threes and fours and sevens and whatever. Mm-hmm. People are under the impression that that information is valid when it's not. Yeah. 100 people could go on who are mad at somebody and put whatever they want up there. 5 people could go on. They don't look at how many people respond. The survey kind of thing. 5 people may respond, and if they were mad, they rated that. And I'll tell you what, I have a problem with those kinds of ratings because they do not speak to what our teachers and parents in the school system do. And people just need to understand that that's not the place to look for data about school systems. If they want it, the Virginia Department of Education has clear data, and you can look at where schools are and how they're actually performing when you make choices about where you want to live and where your kids want to go to school, where you want your kids to go to school.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm not going to say anything. I'm just going to say I agree with everybody what we've said here tonight. I think that we're on the right track. I hope we are. I hope we're providing the money that we thought was needed for the teachers. That was my goal when I first came onto the board, and still is today. And I thought it was starting to work, but I'm not too sure. But anyway, we have action on a closed meeting personnel report. Mr. Copeland.
Mr. Chair. I move that we adopt the personnel report as presented.
Second. Board Member Pichard?
Yes.
Board Member Brooks Buck?
Yes.
Board Member Byram?
Yes.
Board Member Mitnick?
Yes.
Board Member Skeeter?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Copeland?
Aye.
Chairman DeBransky?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Pupil personnel report.
Mr. Chair, I move that we adopt the pupil personnel report as presented.
Second.
Board Member Pichard?
Yes.
Board Member Brooks Buck?
Yes.
Board Member Byram?
Yes.
Board Member Mitnick?
Yes.
Board Member Skeeter?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Copeland?
Aye.
Chairman DeBransky?
Yes.
Motion carried.
The meeting is concluded. Thank you for coming. Be safe going home tonight.